Of a survey brig off the coast of Long Island.
Can only assume that the charge is murder.
A revolt of West African slaves leads to a historic battle that reaches all the way to the Supreme Court of the United States in Steven Spielberg's new epic film called Amistad, one of the new big holiday pictures we'll be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert. We'll also look at Titanic. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. I was very impressed with Amistad, both with its memorable visuals, particularly the image of a thick, long nail as a symbol of slavery, and with the seriousness in which it presents a pre-Civil War argument before the Supreme Court, an argument critical to the essential nature of the United States. In 1839, Africans taken into slavery escape and kill most of their captors aboard ship. The slaves are captured by United States forces and tried for murder. Matthew McConaughey plays a young lawyer named Roger Baldwin who has an ingenious idea how to defend them.
The only way one may sell or purchase slaves is if they are born slaves, as on a plantation. I'm right, aren't I?
Yes.
So are they?
Are they?
Yes. Born slaves, as on a plantation.
Well, we're not certain, but we very much doubt it.
Well, let's say they are. Well, if they are, then they are possessions, and no more deserving of a criminal trial than a bookcase or a plow. And we can all go home, can't we? Now, on the other hand, let's say they aren't slaves. Well, if they aren't slaves, then they were illegally acquired, weren't they?
The intricate legal arguments in this story are not easy to stage cinematically. Spielberg and his screenwriter do a beautiful job.
Open your mouth. Of course, he doesn't understand what I'm saying because he doesn't speak English. Abra su boca. Doesn't he understand that? I thought he was born on a Cuban plantation. That's what they're all saying.
The trial escalates until it is heard before the Supreme Court, where John Quincy Adams, the former sixth president of the United States, argues on behalf of the slaves, knowing full well that the current president, Martin Van Buren, doesn't want to get involved in a case that presages the Civil War debate over slavery. Anthony Hopkins plays Adams. Jaiman Hansu plays Sinkay, the leader of the slave revolt.
We won't be going in there alone.
Alone? Indeed not. No, we have right at our side. We have righteousness at our side. We have Mr. Baldwin over there.
King Baldwin. Muma danimia. Kikilima atie. I met my ancestors. Ngaye peloti gama. I will call into the past. Nasiati hanga wapa. Far back to the beginning of time. And beg them to come and help me.
I plan on taking my kids to see this film, but I will prep them beforehand, not about the violence so much, but about the court case. This is a very heady experience. It's a tricky one, legally, and it's a terrific opportunity for family discussion about the origin and nature of our country, our democracy, built, of course, on a foundation of a lie, slavery. A strong recommendation for me then on Amistad.
It's a very good film, Gene. And one of the things I liked about it was that the character of Sinkay, even though he doesn't speak English, is developed through the use of a translator into a person who was intelligent enough to take part in his own defense and to suggest strategies to his attorney so that you don't get what you so often get in the movies, slaves as faceless victims over there, 100 people on a boat, and none of them individuals. Yep. Here, one of them is an individual. On the other hand, I didn't feel in this film the emotional charge that I often feel from Spielberg. If you look at The Color Purple, Schindler's List, and even some of his more popular films like E.T., there is often a moment when Spielberg, more really than any other director, can really bring you to tears or really reduce you to a real strong emotional response. And here, it was more cerebral. It had more to do with the legal battle than it had to do with the emotional tragedy.
You know what? I think I'll make the brief for the way I saw the picture rather than for him, if you follow me.
Okay.
I mean, I walk in hating slavery. We all do. Mm-hmm. Therefore, I didn't need that. And what I got was a stimulation of learning about the tower in Africa with the pen where people are rounded up. Well, that to me was dramatic. That was very
well.
Powerful.
It's an educational film, but it's more like a docudrama. I mean, not that he's going to make me hate slavery. Of course, I hate slavery, but I wanted more of an emotional payoff than I got.
And I'll tell you one other thing: we've had movies dump on lawyers constantly in the last 5-6 years. Constantly. Here are a couple of lawyers, Roger Baldwin and John Quincy Adams, that do the greatness that the legal profession can do.
You know, Anthony Hopkins, did you recognize him at first when
Not
he was on
first.
Screen? No, I mean...
You know what? I had a question about it. That's how good he is. Well,
could that be Anthony?
He's amazing.
And he also, not just that he disguises himself, it's a good performance.
Nixon, Picasso, John Quincy Adams.
Yeah,
he can do it all.
Pretty amazing. Later in the show, Matt Damon and Robin Williams in Good Will Hunting, the story of a street kid who's a math genius.
I need someone who can get through to him. Like me.
Coming up next, the epic Titanic, about its doomed first and final voyage.
Iceberg, right ahead!
These are some of the things we recovered from your stateroom.
This was mine. How extraordinary. And it looks the same as it did the last time I saw it.
A 101-year-old woman remembers her voyage aboard the doomed ship Titanic in an opening scene from Titanic, which after all the publicity and all the delays and all the reports about its world record budget, turns out to be a glorious Hollywood epic, wonderfully well-crafted and well worth the wait. The film begins with eerie actual footage of the real Titanic in its watery grave 2.5 miles below the sea. Relics brought back from that wreck trigger the old woman's memory, and it's her story told in flashback that provides the movie's dramatic focus. Her name is Rose, and as a young woman, she's played by Kate Winslet. She's engaged to marry a supercilious American millionaire named Hockley, played here by Billy Zane.
I don't see what all the fuss is about. It doesn't look any bigger than the Mauritania.
You could be blasé about some things, Rose, but not about Titanic. It's over 100 feet longer than Mauritania. And far more luxurious.
Also on board for that maiden voyage in 1912, a young passenger named Jack, played by Leonardo DiCaprio. He just won his ticket in a poker game.
You know somebody?
Of course not, that's not the point.
Goodbye, I miss you!
Goodbye!
Goodbye.
I will never forget you!
Although Rose is engaged, she's far from being in love, and Jack's high spirits captivate her. Soon she's sneaking away from her boring fiancé to spend time with this charmer from steerage.
Open your eyes.
I'm flying.
Then the great ship hits an iceberg and slowly starts to sink. The special effects in the film are remarkably convincing and effective, especially in a virtuoso sequence at the end that shows in detail the stages of the Titanic's final convulsion.
I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth had passed away. There was no more sea.
Titanic was written and directed by James Cameron, who was specialized in special effects pictures. New underwater documentary footage is tied effortlessly into scenes that recreate the original ship in all of her glory. And the dramatic tale is handled intelligently and it's acted well. It's not just melodramatic soap opera. But all of those accomplishments pale before the remarkable final hour of the movie, in which the death throes of the Titanic are recreated in spectacular detail. It could have all just been a lot of screaming and running around and fire and steam, but Cameron prepares us for what's going to happen. There's a little documentary animation that they show to the old woman so we know what to look for, and then he structures his film so that we understand how and why the ship is sinking. Titanic is in the great tradition of Hollywood epic filmmaking.
Oh, it's very exciting. And I want to reemphasize the point you made about at the very beginning of the film, she is shown and we are shown using computers intelligently in a movie.
Yes,
a computer simulation of how it sunk. What happened? That it got too close, it couldn't steer very well, all of that. So we now have a blueprint in our heads for exactly what happened for the rest of the picture. Mm-hmm. That's a masterstroke of storytelling.
Yes, it is.
And there's one other element that I want to stress, and that's Leonardo DiCaprio.
Uh-huh.
This guy, finally, from Gilbert Grape, which was a transcendent piece of acting.
Yes, it was.
He's come up with another one in a story that, as you say, could have been melodrama. I think he is just absolutely captivating. Mm-hmm. By comparison, she comes off as flat to me, Kate Winslet. I did think so. He's just great.
All the publicity on this movie almost sank it before it got out of port.
Yeah.
It's really a good movie.
Yeah. Coming up next, straight from his success in The Rainmaker, Matt Damon is back on the screen along with Robin Williams in Good Will Hunting.
I've spoken to the judge, and he's agreed to release you under my supervision.
A brilliant but troubled young man is rescued from jail by a professor who sees the young man's genius and potential in Good Will Hunting, this year's Rain Man. It's an emotionally uplifting, extremely well-acted story of the flowering of a great mind due to some tender, loving care. The red-hot young actor Matt Damon plays a closet genius named Will Hunting, who has emotional problems that have had him underachieving for years, as he works as a janitor in the great school MIT, where he should be the star pupil, really, in mathematics. The teacher, who spots his amazing talent, sends him to a psychologist friend, played by Robin Williams.
You're an orphan, right? Do you think I'd know the first thing about how hard your life has been, how you feel, who you are? Because I read Oliver Twist. I can't learn anything from you. I can't read in some f***ing book. Unless you want to talk about you.
Another key player in the story and the co-writer of this film, along with actor Matt Damon, is the actor Ben Affleck, playing Will's longtime best friend who is frustrated by his friend not living up to his potential.
You don't owe it to yourself.
You owe it to me. Because tomorrow I'm going to wake up and I'll be 50. And I'll still be doing what you get. And you're sitting on a winning lottery ticket. You're too much of a to cash it in. I'd do anything to have what you got.
And there's another person in the film who comes to care deeply about Will, an MIT student played by the fine young actress Minnie Driver.
There's my number. So maybe we can go out for coffee sometime.
All right, yeah. Maybe we could just get together and eat a bunch of caramels.
What do you mean?
When you think about it, it's as arbitrary as drinking coffee.
I suspect Matt Damon is going to get all the buzz from this movie, but Robin Williams comes off the floor from his lame role in Flubber to deliver, I think, one of his best performances in years, a smart, caring psychotherapist without the traditional Robin Williams wild man humor that so often, I think, keeps us from really believing the characters he's playing. Thumbs up for me, a big one for Good Will Hunting.
Yeah, and thumbs up for the script by Damon and Affleck, because they... Yeah. Were able to come up with something that you don't see in the movies. It's real complicated in a couple of ways. First of all, this kid has one mind in a billion. He's one of the most brilliant mathematical minds on the planet. He had this shattered childhood. And for these people to help him, to kind of the woman, the professor, the friend, the friend who says, if you are still here in 10 years, I'm going to kill you, and the psychiatrist, all trying to help him. It's a wonderful building process that allows him to realize his potential. It's such an original idea for a film.
Well, also, they give a sense of place, too. These guys met in Boston or near Boston. They went to school together, these two young actors. Uh-huh. They've got the city right, the accents right, and this Matt Damon is the real deal. He's got the great looks. But these are different characters, Rainmaker. there's a... What can we say about Bunuelian rather than Freudian slip?
Very nicely done. When we come back, Robert Duvall and Billy Bob Thornton in the story of a troubled preacher in The Apostle.
Somebody give me an amen! Yeah.
Lots of good movies on this show, and here comes another one. Our next movie is a triumph of writing, acting, and direction, and sheer human observation, all by Robert Duvall. It's titled The Apostle, and in it, Duvall plays a Pentecostal minister who may do bad things, but is not a bad man. As both writer and director, Duvall seems completely at home in the preacher's world, and he filmed a lot of his scenes using ordinary people instead of actors, as you can sort of sense here in footage from a revival meeting.
I walk with Jesus. I talk with Jesus. I talk with Jesus. I shout with Jesus. I walk with Jesus. I stomp with Jesus. We stomp on the devil.
The minister, nicknamed Sonny, loves to travel, evangelize, and womanize, and that causes trouble at home. His wife takes up with the youth minister, and Sonny paces the attic of his mother's house asking God for guidance.
I love you, Lord. I love you, but I'm mad at you. I am mad at you. So deliver me tonight, Lord. What should I do? Now tell me, should I lay hands on myself? What should I do?
Sonny's wife asks for a divorce, and his church is taken away by his wife and her family, causing great tension when he crashes a Sunday service of the congregation that used to be his. The wife is played by Farrah Fawcett. After committing a serious crime in a raid, Sonny leaves the state, changes his name, and tries to start all over again in rural Louisiana. A redneck racist, played by Billy Bob Thornton, doesn't much like the idea of a white preacher with a mostly black flock.
Well, I just come in to see what's going on, you know. Music was good. Them kids, friends of yours, these folks here?
Well, they're just children of the Lord. Let's put it that way. We are Jesus Church, and they're Jesus children.
Is that right?
Yes, sir.
I'll be down.
Take your hat off.
Oh, I'm sorry. Stand here in the house of the Lord with my hat on. I didn't mean to do that.
The preacher gets a following on the local radio station and a fan in the station secretary, Miranda Richardson. He asks her out on a date and makes his move.
I'm a man, you're a woman. I feel comfortable with you. And I like you.
Well, I like you.
The plot doesn't adhere to a formula, but instead it follows this preacher where his life leads him. He's spiritual and passionate, maybe a little manic and crazy, but he's a good man, and the movie doesn't fall into Elmer Gantry stereotypes. It takes the religion as seriously as the people in the congregation do and provides a portrait of almost documentary conviction. Every once in a while, a regional American character of complete originality appears in a movie. Last year, it was Carl Childers in Sling Blade. This year, it's Sonny Burns in The Apostle.
Well, it's a very good performance. There's no question about it. I like what he does with the cast around him. I mean, Duvall has a lot of respect in the acting community, and look who he has. I mean, when you put Miranda Richardson, you can get Miranda Richardson to take a part that isn't, you know, a leading role like that. It's a compliment to you. And I think she's one of our great actresses. Farrah Fawcett is used very, very well. This is going to jumpstart her career, I suspect. And his direction, his final shot, by the way, is a beautiful piece of directing. Mm-hmm. When we come back, the video pick of the week, a family film that features a visit to Toyland.
Siskel and Ebert's video pick of the week is brought to you by Nestle Raisinets. At the movies or at home, Raisinets.
A new animated version of Babes in Toyland, very loosely inspired by the Victor Herbert operetta, is in video stores for the holiday season, and it's aimed at younger viewers, say from about 3 to about 8 or 9. It stars just about every figure from the Mother Goose nursery rhymes, and kids may have fun picking out their favorites, some of whom only have walk-ons. The main story involves Jack and Jill and their companion Humpty Dumpty, who find themselves together on an expedition to Toyland. Of course, to get there, they take the little engine that could.
Hey, you! Don't you know the difference between a train track and a sidewalk? Tom, the Piper's son.
There's a crisis in Toyland where all of Santa's toys are manufactured. The evil Barnaby, who lives in a gothic manor overlooking the town and is very Scrooge-like, wants to shut down toy production.
Scramble, egghead. Beat it. Exit.
Babes in Toyland is a gentle and sweet-hearted movie just right for younger children who like some thrills and excitement, but nothing too intense. Babes in Toyland is my video pick of the week. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this show, and it was a banner week with nothing but thumbs up for four of the stronger holiday openings. Two thumbs up for Steven Spielberg's Amistad with its legal battle over whether slaves in rebellion were murderers or men exercising their right to freedom. Gene liked it even more than I did. It opens next week. Two enthusiastic thumbs up for James Cameron's Titanic. It opens in 2 weeks. Two more big thumbs up for Good Will Hunting, the absorbing story of a kid from the Boston streets who is a math genius. And finally, two more thumbs up for Robert Duvall's The Apostle, which gives us one of the most original movie characters of the year. It also opens in 2 weeks. So, Gene, here are four movies that are likely to figure in the Academy Awards. And finally, at the end of the year, the quality starts to come to the theater.
Yes, because it hasn't been a great year. It's becoming a very good one. Remember, you can check our votes and hear our reviews of recent movies at our website, the address, Siskel-Ebert.com. That's it for this week. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of more big holiday movies, including For Richer or Poorer, starring Tim Allen and Kirstie Alley as New Yorkers on the run from the IRS, and also Scream 2 with Neve Campbell, Sarah Michelle Gellar, and Courtney Cox, menaced once again by a mysterious killer. That's next week. Until then, the balcony is closed.
Here's a Christmas gift for your VCR, the brand new 1998 edition of Roger Ebert's Video Companion. Over 1,500 full-length reviews.